The Patriot Act. The terrorist attack on Charlie Hebdo. And the suicide bombing of a Pakistani elementary school. All of this and more on the Cole Bear Report.
Shut up.
Hi, I'm Cole Katz, currently bringing you current events that just happened. Currently. Tonight I'll be talking about some of the most brutal terrorist attacks that changed the lives of thousands and impacted the lives of us all. The topic for my documentary is terrorism around the world, and I'll be starting off with the Islamic State of Iraq, also known as ISIS or ISIL. They are a Middle Eastern Sunni jihadist organization that claims the right to form an Islamic state in the countries of Iraq, Syria, and other parts of the Levant, which is a Middle Eastern area. They see anyone who doesn't believe their beliefs as an infidel or an apostle and will beat them or kill them. ISIS was founded on October 13, 2005, when the AQI, or Al-Qaeda in Iraq, declared the establishment of the Islamic State of Iraq. Their aim was to seize power in central and western areas of Iraq and turn it into a Sunni Islamic state. In the article, the author gives a history of the formation of ISIS, like how they formally chopped the IS out of their name to call themselves just the Islamic State. It explains how ISIS wants to go back to the times of Muhammad, where the violence that is taboo today was normal. They believe that if this happens, the Islamic State will be formed and the world will be at peace. Lastly, the article tells us how a modern-day caliph is picked and gives a history of the four caliphs to ever peacefully rule over an Islamic State. The caliph must basically be strong, adult, an Islamic male with no defects, and he must lead the country in war. The requirements are so loose that many people wonder why so few of them have been picked since 1924. I agree with the article, because Baghdadi, the current leader of ISIS, has goals that are completely unaccomplishable in any way. You can't enslave the Middle East. The thing is, Baghdadi's goals are completely unaccomplishable in today's standards, because today we value peace, we value equality, and we value human rights for everyone. And Baghdadi's views completely clash with everything that the world values. He can't accomplish the goals without bloodshed and possibly a world war. I agree with the author's point of view on the subject and think that al-Baghdadi is an extremist, terrorist, and fanatic. Recently, though, al-Baghdadi has been kidnapping and beheading American journalists on video. Here are a few pictures.
The United States of America will continue to do what we must do to protect our people. We will be vigilant and we will be relentless. When people harm Americans anywhere, we do what's necessary to see that justice is done, and we act against ISIL, standing alongside others.
I am Stephen Joel Sotloff. I'm sure you know exactly who I am by now and why I am appearing before you. And now, it is time for my message. Obama, your foreign policy of intervention in Iraq was supposed to be for the preservation of American lives and interests. So why is it that I'm having to pay the price of your interference with my life? Am I not an American citizen? You've spent billions of U.S. taxpayers' dollars and we've lost thousands of our troops in our previous fighting against the Islamic State. So where's the American people's interests in reigniting this war? From what little I know about foreign policy, I remember a time when you could not win an election without promising to bring our troops back home from Iraq and from Afghanistan and to close down Guantanamo. Here you are now, Obama, nearing the end of your term and having achieved none of the above, and deceivingly marching us, the American people, into a blazing fire.
I'm back, Obama, and I'm back because of your arrogant foreign policy towards the Islamic State, because of your insistence in continuing your bombings in Amman, Zamar, and the Mosul Dam, despite our serious warnings. You, Obama, have yet again, through your actions, killed yet another American citizen. So just as your missiles continue to strike our people, our knife will continue to strike the necks of your people.
The United States is currently bombing ISIS in different places across the Middle East in an attempt to slow down their gain of territory. Even more recent, other Middle Eastern countries are teaming up with the United States to bomb ISIS, and allegedly, Al-Qaeda, another terrorist organization, has even said that ISIS is going way too far. In reality, though, ISIS has been around for longer than you expect. It's been around since 2005, and one of the only reasons that it was brought to the public's attention is the beheadings of the three American journalists. This was a mistake to not recognize them sooner, because their potential threat has been growing ever since, and it would have been easier to stifle them had they done so sooner. And speaking of Al-Qaeda carried out the 9/11 attacks, which directly led to the U.S. Patriot Act.
Benjamin Franklin warned us against trading liberty for security. Unfortunately, he's probably rolling in his grave today. I doubt he's too pleased about the Patriot Act. The uniting and strengthening America by providing appropriate tools required to intercept and obstruct terrorism act of 2001. The Patriot Act. Politicians, of course, love to give great sounding names to bills. So if you vote against the Patriot Act, you must be unpatriotic, right? Well, not exactly, because the Patriot Act has taken away a lot of our liberties. It has given the federal government an unprecedented amount of power to monitor the phone calls and emails of US citizens without a warrant. That's clearly a violation of the Fourth Amendment. No way around that. One of the most controversial parts of the Patriot Act is Section 215, which allows the government to collect metadata on Americans. You may have heard President Obama say, "Oh, well, that's not that big of a deal. They're just collecting information that can be found on someone's phone bill, their number, the length of the call, and the time." However, there is still reason to be concerned. A study published by Stanford University shows that it's possible to infer a great deal about a person by just collecting their metadata. They studied 546 volunteers over a short amount of time. During that time, they had people call pharmacies, legal services, financial services, firearms dealers, religious organizations, political office holders, and campaigns. Using just metadata, in some cases, they were able to correctly infer about a person's religious affiliations, medical conditions, close friends, romantic partners, whether they had a gun, whether they had a drug or alcohol addiction, and more. The good news is that Section 215 will sunset on June 1st of this year. There's a movement in Congress to stop a clean reauthorization of it. Even original sponsors of the Patriot Act have said that Section 215 has been misinterpreted and abused. I would encourage you to call your reps to let them know that you are paying attention to the Section 215 debate and tell them to vote against a clean reauthorization of Section 215. Now, I'm sure some of you are saying, let's get rid of the Patriot Act altogether. And I'm with you on that. There's a bill in Congress that would do exactly that. And I would encourage you to check out the FreedomWorks blog where you can learn more information. Check it out today.
The Patriot Act gave the government permission to monitor phone calls, emails, and all other forms of electronic communication, including the Postal Service, in the name of keeping our country safe. More specifically, if they suspected you were a terrorist, they could look at all of your personal calls, emails, and anything else that was on the internet. Even though this act violates our rights and freedoms, it was still passed. The act, however, did say that the information had to be relevant. Obama took advantage of the use of the word relevant in the act. Obama then started retrieving phone calls and emails, regardless of whether they suspected you to be a terrorist or not, all because it happened to be quote-unquote relevant information to the government. In that case, the word relevant did not define a line that separated the information that they could have access to and the information that they couldn't, since anything could be relevant as long as it has an explanation. The article I researched discusses why the invasion of privacy is unjustified and how Congress approved the act with the knowledge of this serious loophole. I believe we should have an act like this to protect us from terrorists, but the way that it was implemented in the USA Patriot Act was completely unprecedented and unhelpful. This is because that the word relevant made anything that the government wanted relevant to maintaining national security. And regardless of any interpretations of this act, the government has no right to monitor anyone's calls whatsoever unless they have substantial proof and evidence that the person they are listening in on is a terrorist or is suspected to be one. Currently, people are protesting and refining the bill, and the man who wrote up the act is currently trying to pass a second revision of it through Congress. This ties into my overarching topic of terrorism, because terrorism is the reason that this act was passed. There are other terrorist organizations, too, such as the Pakistani Taliban, who took responsibility for an attack where militants entered a military-run school, got onto the stage in the auditorium, and started shooting at the students. The attack left 148 teachers and students, almost all of them young, dead or wounded. Here are photos from the attack. And as I already said, the Pakistani Taliban took responsibility for the attack, and they are now supposedly waging a new campaign against the Pakistani authorities. Currently, Pakistan is doing all it can to suppress the Taliban and will continue to try to protect the people of their country. However, the author was possibly biased because, as he was an American, he takes the more anti-terrorism side. And regardless of his values or the common knowledge that terrorism is completely wrong, it is still considered biased. And so, technically, this does show bias.
The Charlie Hebdo attacks. Two armed and masked Muslim gunmen stormed into the Charlie Hebdo magazine building and assassinated many of the magazine's top cartoonists and editors in retaliation for them depicting the Prophet Muhammad in sexual and embarrassing poses. It is said that even depicting the Prophet in any way is a sin. The attack is a violation of the cartoonists' rights to freedom of speech and freedom of press. It is still unsure as to whether the gunmen acted independently or were affiliated with a terrorist group while carrying out the attack. To further add to the confusion, multiple terrorist organizations have tried to take credit for the attack, as they all saw the incident as a great opportunity to build their reputation.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead. Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. To the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart but your head gets dumb. So much to do, so much to see. So what's wrong with taking the back streets? You'll never know if you don't go. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on, get paid. And they say it gets colder. You're bundled up now, wait till you get older. But the media men beg to differ. Just
judging by the hole in the satellite picture. The ice we skate is getting pretty thin. The water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. My world's